ॐ स्थापकाय च धर्मस्य सर्वधर्मस्वरूपिणे अवतार वरिष्ठाय रामकृष्णाय ते नमः। ओ राम कृष्ण द एस्टैब्लिशर ऑफ द इटर्नल रिलीजन द एम्बॉडीमेंट ऑफ ऑल रिलीजन्स एंड द बेस्ट ऑफ ऑल इनकार्नेशंस वी सैल्यूट थी। इन द लास्ट रीडिंग क्लास वी लेफ्ट एट पेज 522 ऑफ दिस बुक राम कृष्ण द ग्रेट मास्टर वॉल्यूम 1। We shall continue today from there. In the last reading, we noticed that the author, Swami Sharadananda, so he was mentioning about the extraordinary features of the incarnations. And Sri Ramakrishna as an incarnation, he cited several examples. It was extraordinary. Nobody could equal, much less excel him. So we got so many instances as examples from his life. We will continue today the same subject. We have already said that the master used to remain in the Bhava Mukha at all times except during the Nirvikalpa Samadhi. This is why we see that he used to have different spiritual relations of love with the different devotees, a particular relation with a particular devotee, and he always kept the relation intact. His lifelong filial relationship with all women who are special manifestations of bliss-giving and nourishing aspects of the mother of the universe is now well known to all. But the fact that he had particular relationship with individual men devotees is perhaps not yet generally known. Therefore, it will not be out of place here to say something in this connection. The master divided his devotees into two broad categories, one born of a part of Shiva and the other of that of Vishnu. He said that the devotees of these two groups differed in their nature and behavior and in their love for spiritual exercises. And he could clearly understand the difference. But it is almost beyond our power to explain to the reader what this difference was. The two classes of devotees. Therefore, let the reader know this much, that the characters of Shiva and Vishnu are, as it were, two molds or two models, and the mental makeup of the devotees is cast in these two molds. The master had all kinds of spiritual relationship of love, namely Shanta, Dasya, Sakya, Vatsalya, Madhura. He established with all those devotees. He had particular relation with particular persons. For example, he used to say of Narendranath, Narendra is as it were my counterpart. Narendra is as it were my counterpart. The principle that resides within this showing himself is female, and that which is within him showing Narendranath is male. Sri Ramakrishna used to say, yeah, the mother's nature is more is there, but inside him, father's nature is there, male. He looked upon Swami Vivekananda, Swami Brahmananda, as his very son. The master had a particular relationship of this nature with each of the special devotees, both lay and monastic. And it is needless to say that he had the relationship of Shanta, calmness, with the ordinary devotees, for he had the firm conviction that they were forms of Narayana himself. It is on knowing the internal nature of each of the devotees that the master had a particular spiritual relationship established with him. For he used to say, I clearly see everything in man's mind like the articles in a glass case. See everything inside the mind of a person as one sees through the glass into the glass case. One can never act contrary to one's nature. Therefore, it was not in the power of any of the devotees to act contrary to that spiritual relationship of love in which the master stood to him. If, however, anyone in imitation of another acted contrarily, the master felt much annoyed and would clearly point out his mistake. As an example, we cite the case of a devotee. The devotee of the master called Girish, a Bhairava, Girish Chandra Ghosh, a great dramatist and actor himself, extraordinary good actor. So him Sri Ramakrishna called as Bhairava. Bhairava is a divine being who is serving Shiva always. So Bhairava. One day he saw during his ecstasy in the temple of Kali that Girish was a Bhairava. Bhairavas are a kind of terrific demigods addicted to strong drinks and meat eating and noted for their extraordinary powers. They are devoted to Shiva and followers of Shiva. So Bhairavas. So Girish, he pointed out as is a Bhairava, is a follower of Shiva with the tendency to eat anything he likes like meat and drink beyond all measure. So all these were traits of those Bhairavas. So he had inherited that nature from his birth itself. One day another beloved devotee of the master, so extraordinary, saw that there was extraordinary tender feeling. Girish was a Bhairava. He would smilingly put up with Girish's importunities and rude language because he was born with that. His language was rude from the very birth. So he put up with that one. For he saw that there was an extraordinary tender feeling and complete dependence hidden under the covering of the rudeness of his language. We see in other common people also, people from the village, their language is rather rude, not very courteous. They will never say, please come, come, they say. You will be shocked. What is this? He's just this fellow much rudier to me. Instead of calling, please come, come, he says. He's from a village, he does not know all that courtesy. But his feeling towards you is very tender, very loving, just like that. He's a Bhairava, though he used to use rude language. And Sri Ramakrishna knew it. Therefore, he never took offense. So, hidden under this covering of the rudeness of his language, he could understand his real feelings. One day, another beloved devotee to the master imitated Girish's rude language in his behavior with Sri Ramakrishna, at which the master became extremely displeased with him and afterwards pointed out his mistake. You should not imitate somebody else. That is his born nature. So I allow me to do that. A villager comes and asks you, he may use, instead of using the respectful word, so you, he wants to thou, thee. So thee is much, disrespectful. You don't use it towards the elders. So a villager can use it, tu, in Hindi. He said tu and tu me. Tu me means a more respectable word for you, but a much lesser one to use for a child or your servant, tu. Like that, if a villager uses mistakenly towards an elderly person or a respectable person, tu, you don't mind it. Poor man does not know the language, or he has been brought up in a language like that. But if a respectable, educated man comes and calls you through, knowing full well all the intricacies of language, you do not take it lightly. You point out whatever you think about me, and you will have a quarrel with him. Extremely displeased with him, and afterwards pointed out his mistake. Through various means did the master lead the devotees. Established in Bhava Mukha, the master knew well the spiritual mood natural to each man or woman, and in accordance with that mood had a relationship of love with him or her. We shall here present the leader with some of the numerous methods the master would adopt in leading each devotee to the realization of God according to his spiritual mood. It was after he came down from the non-dual spiritual plane in his first vision of the Divine Mother in the temple that the master practiced the spiritual devotional moods of Sakya, Vatsalya and Madhura to experience directly the bliss of those moods and attain the highest stage in each of them. Long afterwards, when the devotees of the inner circle came to him, one day the desire arose in Master's mind that the devotees also might experience ecstasy, and he prayed to the Divine Mother accordingly, and immediately some of them began to have such experiences. In that mood of spirituality, their consciousness of the external world, including their own bodies, grew dim to a certain extent, and an internal current of a particular spiritual mood, for example, the thought of a form of God, became so manifest that they saw that form come, stand before them, smile, speak, and thinks as if it were vividly living, and do things like that. They mostly experience that state while they listen to devotional songs, music, etc. So Sri Ramakrishna could invoke such moods on others by simple prayer. The devotees and visions of gods and goddesses. The master had another class of devotees who did not have a similar experience when listening to devotional music, but had visions of forms of gods at the time of meditation. To begin with, they had visions of mere forms. Then with the deepening of meditation, they saw their movements and heard their words. Others again had various kinds of visions in the beginning, but did not have any when their meditation grew deeper. But it is a matter of great surprise that immediately on hearing about the visions and experience of each of them, Sri Ramakrishna knew the class to which each belonged. His current needs and his future visions and experiences. Whatever experience he has got now, Sri Ramakrishna could say, in future you are going to have such and such an experience, or you would not have such experiences again. So he was almost like a dictionary for everything. Everything was known to him. So let us mention here one devotee as an example. Instructed by Sri Ramakrishna, one of our friends, who was later on became Swami Abhedananda. So Swami Abhedananda began practicing meditation and other spiritual practices, and in the beginning began to see clearly his chosen ideal in various forms at the time of meditation. He used to go to the master Dakshineshwar at short intervals and inform him of his experiences. On hearing of them, the master would say, "Very good, practice this way," and so on. Later, that friend saw at the time of meditation that all the forms of gods and goddesses merged in the body of one form. When the master came to know it, he said, fine, you have the vision of Vaikuntha, you will have no more visions. Our friend said, as a matter of fact, that was what exactly happened. I could not any longer see any form, whatever, during meditation. Higher ideas, such as the all-pervadingness of the Divine Lord, arose in my mind and occupied it. I had then a great liking to have visions of forms and tried hard to have them again, but all to no purpose. No form could be seen anymore. Sri Ramakrishna knew. He has seen. He had come to 11. There was no necessity for any more visions for him. He will see without vision the higher forms of meditation and experiences. So Sri Ramakrishna would predict what would happen. The master's instruction to the devotees of God. At the time of meditation, said the master to the devotees who believe that God had forms, think that you have tied with a silk thread your mind to the lotus feet of your chosen form of God, so that your mind may not stray away from there. It's all mental. Mentally imagine a silk thread has tied your mind to the feet of your Ishta Devata. Why do I say silk thread? Because those lotus feet are indeed very soft and delicate. They will be hurt if any other kind of string is used. So even in the mind, when you imagine God as the softest personality, so you cannot tie any other hard thread or rope about it. So silk thread is used to tie one's mind to the feet of the Lord. He would sometimes say, should one think of the chosen ideal at the time of meditation only and then forget him at other times? You should always keep a part of the mind attached to him. You must surely have noticed that a sacrificial lamp has to be lighted at the time of the worship of Durga. That light should always be kept burning near the deity. It should not be allowed to go out. If it does, it augurs ill for the householder. Even so, after the chosen ideal is brought and seated on the lotus of the heart, the sacrificial lamp of meditation on him should always be kept burning. While one is engaged in worldly duties, one should watch at intervals whether that lamp is burning within or not. That means keep a part of the mind always on God, even while you are performing the worldly duties. Wash the mind out before meditation. Sometimes Sri Ramakrishna would say, in those days, before beginning to meditate on the chosen ideal, I imagined that I was thoroughly flushing out the inside of my mind. You see, there exist various kinds of dirt and dust, bad thoughts and desires within the mind. I imagined that I was washing them off and was then making the chosen ideal sit there. Do just like that. So the mind was something like a very solid thing for him. It was so clear about the properties of the mind, the behavior of the mind. He would suggest means how to control that mind, how to mold it. Which doctrine higher? God with forms or God without forms? The master spoke to us at one time about the meditation on the two aspects of the Divine Lord, the one with forms and the other without forms. Some reach the formless aspect through that with forms. Others attain that with forms through the formless. At the house of the great devotee Girish, a friend of us, he was called Devendranath Basu, one day asked him, "Sir, which is higher, the conception of God with forms or that without forms?" There are, replied the master, two kinds of conception about the formless aspect, the ripe and the unripe. The ripe conception of the formless aspect of God is high indeed. One has to reach that through the aspect with forms. As regards the unripe conception of formless aspect, it is all darkness as soon as one shuts one's eyes, as is the case with the Brahmas. They don't have any clear idea. So they think we want to meditate on formless God. When they close their eyes, they get into oblivion. It is almost like going into sleep. You don't experience anything at all. Almost you are sleeping without people knowing that you are sleeping. As the result of Western education, there was also another circle of devotees of the master who were proceeding in sadhana through the unripe conception of the formless aspect of God. He forbade them to imitate the Christian missionaries in condemning the meditation of the aspect of God with forms. In hating the devotees going towards sadhana, in going forward in sadhana with the help of images of other symbols of the Divine Lord, and in calling them idolaters, blind believers, and so on. He said, it is true that he is with forms, and it is equally true that he is without forms. Who knows what else he is besides these? Do you know how God with forms is? Just like water and ice. By freezing, water becomes ice. Ice is water inside as well as outside. Ice is nothing but water. But look here, water has no form. It has no particular shape, but ice has. Similarly, the indivisible, the existence knowledge bliss, the Satchidananda, gets condensed as it were through one's devotion and assumes various forms like ice. What a fantastic example. It is beyond our power to assess how many people got mental peace through this example of the master, which produced in them the conviction that it was possible for both the aspects of the Divine Lord to coexist. Just as ice becomes water, water becomes ice, without knowing. When it becomes hot in the atmosphere, then ice becomes water. When it becomes cold in the atmosphere, then the water becomes ice. The form becomes formless. Formless will become form. It goes on in a very natural way. Both of them can coexist also. In the North Pole, there is a perennial ice. And down in our plains, the African continent, water is only water. There is no trace of ice. Both of them are simultaneously there. At the poles of the earth, there is ice, and at African oceans, so it is all only water. Both of them simultaneously existing. So water has form, water has no form at the same time. What fantastic examples of the master. We cannot make mention here. We cannot but make mention here of another fact. Swami Vivekananda was the foremost in the circle of the master devotees following the unripe doctrine of the formless aspect of the divinity. The master placed him above all, not only of this class of devotees, but of all classes of them. Having come under the influence of the Western education and the Brahma Samaj, the Swami used sometimes to pass uncharitable remarks on the devotees. This mood was particularly noticeable in him at the time of argumentation. But the master enjoyed the fun sometimes by bringing about a vehement discussion between him and some devotees of God with forms. During such discussion, it often happened that none could stand his argument, that is Swami Vivekananda's arguments, and some felt hurt when silenced by his keen intellect. The master also described joyfully that fact to many persons on many an occasion and said, "The other day, Narayan cut to pieces the arguments of so-and-so with the least effort. Oh, what a sharp intellect," and so on. But the Swami was silenced on one occasion during a discussion with Girish, who followed the doctrine of God with form. It seemed to us on that occasion that in order to make Girish's faith more firm and perfect, the master was on his side. However, in the course of conversation with the master on another occasion, Swami Vivekananda referred to the faith of the devotees of God with forms as blind faith. The master said in reply, "Well, can you explain to me what you call blind faith? The whole of faith is indeed blind, as faith in the eye. Speak either of faith or of knowledge. But no, you will speak of some as blind and some as having eyes. How is that?" Said the Swami later, "Indeed, I was in a fix in trying to explain to the master that day the meaning of blind faith. I could find no meaning for that expression." See, Swamiji, such an intelligent man, Sri Ramakrishna found out his mistake in his expression. That was not a proper expression for the ideas he had in his mind. So he was corrected by Sri Ramakrishna's super intellect. "I could find no meaning for that expression. I have given up using that phrase since then, as I was convinced of the truth of the master's contention. The master used to view the followers of the unripe doctrine of God without forms and the devotees of God with forms with the same eye. He told them also what form of meditation would be helpful. "Look here," he said, in those days I used to imagine the Divine Lord to be an ocean filling the whole universe and me to be a fish diving, floating, swimming in that vast sea of existence, knowledge, bliss. And again, sometimes I consider myself to be a pitcher immersed in the water of that indivisible Satchidananda, existence, knowledge, bliss, infinite, pervading me through and through." The master advised the devotees to meditate on his form. He would again say, "Look here, once think of this," showing himself, "before sitting down for meditation. Why do I say so? Because you have faith here. Thinking of this will remind you of that Divine Lord. Haven't you noticed? Just as when one sees a herd of cows, one remembers the cowherd. When one sees the son, one is reminded of the father. When one sees a pleader, one recalls the court. So is this case. Do you understand? The mind is scattered here, there and everywhere. Thinking of this, it will get collected in one place and right meditation will follow when it is directed on God. Moreover," he would say, "hold fast to some form of God or some mood, whomever or whichever you like, it is then only that there will be steadfastness." So we shall hear such preachings, such teachings, wonderful teachings on meditation, on contemplation, on spiritual practices in our next class. Today we shall close here itself. Niranjanam nityam anantarupam bhaktanukampadhrita vigraham vai ईशावतारं परमेशमीड्यं तं रामकृष्णं शिरसा नमामः. ओ राम कृष्ण द टेंटलेस वन द इटर्नल वन द वन विथ इन्फिनिट फॉर्म्स द वन हु हैज अस्यूम्ड ए फॉर्म आउट ऑफ कंपैशन टू द डिवोटीज द इनकॉर्नेट सुप्रीम सोल एंड द एडोरेबल लॉर्ड ऑफ ऑल. We salute thee, bowing our heads before you.